Good morning, Southside Community Church. It is a beautiful day. The glory of God is shining all around us, and we really need God to help us this morning to focus on Him, to have His Holy Spirit lift us with our bodies, our minds, our hearts, to be in a living, deeper connection with Him, because the world is not helping that. The world is trying to pull us away from Christ and not help us walk with Christ. And today is a beautiful day. And so the first thing I want to do is thank God for our mothers. This is Mother's Day, and I want to thank God for every mother that God has given throughout the world that is loving and raising their babies and helping them grow to be healthy adults. And so we want to praise God for all our moms. And so if you're a mom watching this right now, we thank God for you. God bless you. May God give you extra strength, extra wisdom, and even extra joy today and going into this next week. So we thank God for you. And we want to open now in prayer. So if you're watching this live streaming in your home, your apartment, even in your car, if you're watching in your car, you shouldn't be doing that. You should be driving. But if you're at home in your apartment or house, please stand, and we're going to lift our hearts in prayer before God's holy throne. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, Father God, Holy Spirit, truly when we say, Lord, we need you, it is one of the most profound sentences. Lord, with all our bodies, with all our emotions, with all of our hearts and minds, with all the circumstances in our lives, Lord, we need you. We need you to help us. We need your wisdom. We need your guidance. We need your help, your protection. We need you to give us health. Lord, we need you to intervene on this whole world, this whole planet, Lord, that you would stop the pandemic, and that you would pour out your mercy and healing, and that you would draw all people by your love, by your kindness, to salvation and true life in Jesus Christ. Lord, this time that we are here gathered together in this live stream worship service, Lord, we want to glorify Jesus Christ. And so we beg you, we ask you, in love, because you first loved us, Lord, help us to express our love to you now. Help us to be unified in a very powerful way by your Holy Spirit, by your love for us. May everything we do at home, in our apartments, or here right now with the worship team in the sanctuary, Lord, may we all glorify our only true God and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we pray this in his holy name. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, Southside community. It's good to see all you out there. There's really nobody out here except for Christian, but that's okay. You know, we're going to connect with you guys. I was thinking about this idea of resurrection power this last week, and by definition, resurrection power only happens when there's death involved, death of a dream, death of an era, death of self, death of self-service. And it's in the midst of that death that we're experiencing that Jesus can come in, and the power of the resurrection suddenly shows up. It's a quiet power. It's power that's not necessarily noticed by the world or experienced by the world, but it's there. And it's power that gives us hope. It's power that gives us strength. It's power that allows us to be courageous in the face of difficult times or difficult circumstances. So this first song that we're going to sing is Mercy, and I really love this first line. It says, "Here I am a sinner, broken and in need of you. Take my life and wash my fears away." And it's really when we come to God in that broken place, when we experience the death of our self-sufficiency, is when then God shows up. And he wants to give us new life. He wants to take the reins. He wants to take control. Whereas before, we were actually running the show. And so as we sing this song, we can sing to Jesus that he is our God. He is our Savior. He is the one that has full control of every circumstance. And he knows exactly what we're going through. Thank you.
sinner, broken and in need of you. Take my life and wash my fears away. For you are the great I am. Rest assured to feel your hand holding me until the darkness clears. Father to the fatherless, Redeemer of my soul, my life is yours forever. My heart will always know your mercy saved me. Mercy made me whole. Your mercy found me, called me as your own. Here I am, a sinner, and wash my fears away. For you are the great I am. Rest assured to feel your hand holding me until the darkness clears. Father to the fatherless, Redeemer of my soul, my life is yours forever. My heart will always know your mercy saved me. Mercy made me whole. Your mercy found me, called me as your own. Sinner, broken and in need of you, take my life and wash my fears away.
Nice. And you know, during this pandemic, as we have these shutdowns, it's real easy to become isolated and to feel alone and lonely. I know a lot of people are feeling that way. And yet, it's really the presence of God that can give us courage. It can give us strength as we connect to God in an emotional and even a spiritual way. And it's the presence that provides a main part of that power. As we take a look at the Israelites, and they were wandering in the desert for the Promised Land, it was Lord Jesus that showed up and he led them, and it was his presence before Israel that gave Israel confidence. It gave them strength and provision. And so during this time that we might be feeling alone, we know that we can go to God and we can connect to him and allow his presence to just seep in to our inner being, to where our emotions are, and to fill us with a sense of joy, a sense of peace, a sense that he's got it all under control.
I long life with the light of your presence. This is my heart's desire. Oh, Father, come and let your spirit abide. I long for your presence. This is my heart's desire. I long to be washed in the well of your mercy. I long to be warmed by the fire of your glory. I long for your presence. I long for your healing touch. Come, O Lord, and fill up my life with the light of your presence. This is my heart's desire. Oh, Father, come and let your spirit abide. I long for your presence. This is my heart's desire. It's my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, you're my desire. I want to feel your presence. I want to feel your presence. Come, O Lord, and fill up my life with the light of your presence. This is my heart's desire. Oh, Father, come and let your spirit abide. I long for your presence. This is my heart's desire. It's my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, you're my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, it's my desire. Lord, you're my desire. Lord, you're my desire.
Nice. And you know, we serve an unchanging God. Our salvation is really based on what He's done for us, not what we do. Because our love can be fickle. Our love can change so much. And it's really fortunate for us that we serve a God that's unchanging and His love never changes for us. If we belong to Him, we're part of His family. And it's that faithfulness to Him that gives us a sense of assuredness, a sense that we are indeed saved. Even though we may not act like it, we still can be. We still are. And so we can sing to our God to realize that our salvation is not based on us. It's based on Him and what He's done. And that gives us a real good sense of security.
Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. You never change. You never fail, oh God. True are your promises. True are your promises. You never change. You never fail, oh God. So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. Yeah, we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. What is your love and grace? What is your love and grace? You never change, you never fail, oh God. So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. Yeah, we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. Yeah, we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One, who was and is to come. Great is your faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. You never change, you never fail, oh God.
Awesome. And I think this is part of the service where we give our tithes and offerings.
This is one of these moments where supernaturally all of us should have a little bit of a goosebump thing going on, because God has been doing so much in our hearts and in our minds, and he's caused us to be experiencing isolation physically, but a deeper connection with him and a deeper connection with each other. And I so appreciate the calls that you've given me, the emails you've given me, and I know the calls I've made out to others and the times I've been able to even see one person have been so meaningful. So our love for each other is, as the body of Christ, is so significant. And our love for all of people is actually growing. I think the ways that we want to reach out and help people is growing. And even with our missionaries, our giving that you have been doing so fantastically because of your love for Jesus Christ, we are able to bless our missionaries in a greater way. And so we are sending out extra gifts. Our board has approved this, and we are sending out extra gifts to our missionaries to bless them so that they can do more in places that have greater needs than we have all over this world. We are able to help and bless and especially reach the neediest people and help them. So I praise God for your love for Jesus Christ. I praise God for your faithful giving. And so as we give now, let us rejoice. Let us praise God for all that he is doing to help and to bless and to heal. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, first we need to thank you and praise you because you are the lover of all humankind. You love every person on this planet. There's nobody, Lord, nobody in Iran or in North Korea or any part of this world. Lord, every person is important to you and you love them. The neediest homeless person in Sacramento, you know them by name. You know every hair on their head and you want to love them and show them your love, and you are doing that. So Lord, we pray now that you will bless us to love others as you love them with a greater degree of practical help, that we would reach out with our love and the gospel of Jesus and in every tool you've given us to be a blessing to others. Lord, we give you this offering now, and we ask you to bless it. Bless it for your glory. Bless it to bring healing to the needy and the sick. Lord, bless it to bring the salvation of Jesus Christ to thousands, and Lord, beyond our imagination, even millions. Lord, we pray this now to your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And you know, as we come to God in our brokenness and our bankruptcy, he's able to meet us right there where we're at. And it's there in that midst, in that presence with the Lord, that we get our sense of security, we get a sense of our salvation. We have a sense of just a solidness, a wholeness. And then he reassures us. He lets us know that no matter what we do, he still has us. With all those different things, it allows the resurrection power to take hold. And it gives us courage and it gives us strength to go out in boldness and to be able to share with people genuinely, sincerely. And he may have a calling for all of us. In fact, I know he does. And it's just really a matter of just figuring out what our calling is. But it allows us to say, how awesome are you, God, that you have restored me, you've made me whole. And it's in that part of that resurrection that we can go out and we can serve a broken and hurting world.
Great are you, Lord, mighty in strength. You are faithful and you will ever be. We will praise you all of our days. It's for your glory we offer. Thing. Raise your hands, all your nations, shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Where you send us, God, we will go. You're the answer. We want the world to know. We will trust you when you call our name. Where you lead us, we'll follow all the way. Raise your hands, all your nations, shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
Good job.
Don't go away. We'll be right back. We're just going to reset up, and I'm going to bring the message in just a minute. I am excited to share with you this morning a message from 1 Corinthians. And one of the realities that Jesus came to give us is a life in Him that is completely different than normal, physical, biological life that is just of this world. Because this world is really the tiniest bit of all the reality that God has created. And He wants us to know the fullness of life. He wants us to know the fullness of Him. And as we read 1 Corinthians 15, and we spend some time listening to God this morning, it's my hope and my desire for you that you will catch in your heart and your mind and your soul, the depth of your being, the reality of the gift that God wants you to have and live in every single minute of every single day, because it's so great. It is so huge. It's God's size. So when we talk about living today in the power of the resurrection, I'm not talking about drinking 10 Red Bulls and running around like a crazy person. I'm not talking about just feeling stronger in a physical sense in your body, because our bodies, even at their very strongest, are still very weak. How weak are our bodies? A tiny virus you can't even see with the naked eye can put you in the hospital. That's how weak our bodies are. And yet, God reveals His power in us and through us when we draw near to Him by trust and love and obedience in Jesus Christ. So I'm going to begin reading in 1 Corinthians 15, and we're going to see how God wants us to have and live and experience the fullness of the power of the resurrection of Christ. We're going to see the centrality of the good news of Jesus. In verses 1 through 10 of 1 Corinthians 15, "Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel, the good news, which I preached to you." This is Paul speaking to the Corinthians. "Which you also received," and we as Southside Community Church have received this gospel from Jesus Christ, "in which you stand." This is where we live. This is where we have our being, and we have our address, our homes, our church is built here in Jesus Christ. This is where we stand. "By which you also are saved." Our salvation is in Jesus Christ. "If you hold fast the word which I preached to you," that is the word of God, "unless you believed in vain," that is in your own vanity, your own pride. "For I delivered to you as of first importance that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that He appeared to Cephas," the Apostle Peter, "and then to the 12. After that, He appeared to more than 500 at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep." That is, some have laid down their bodies and they've gone to be with God. "Then He appeared to James and to all the apostles, and last of all, as it were, to one untimely born, He appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles, who am not even fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am," that is, today in Christ. "And His grace toward me did not prove vain," that is, useless, empty, "but I labored even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God within me." So we see first that Christ died, buried, resurrected. That's the reality. That's the ground of our being. That's the foundation of our whole life. Christ did live. Christ did die. He really did die on the cross. There were professional witnesses there, the soldiers that actually crucified Him. They were in charge of making sure, yep, that body hanging there is dead. And then it was buried. He was buried for 3 days in a solid rock tomb, sealed with the governor's seal, guarded with professional Romans, soldiers. And then He rose on the third day, according to the power of God. Christ is real. The resurrection is real. We do not have a fairy tale faith. We do not have a fairy tale God. God is sovereign over the whole earth, over all of creation, over every universe, every galaxy, every star, every sun, everything, every atom in your body. God is sovereign. And the resurrection and all the witnesses of the resurrection speak to us of the reality of what God has done. So now, we get to live a different kind of life. When you look in verses 21 through 34, so just turn over one page in your Bible from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 21 to 34. We've seen Paul testify, we've seen the apostles testify, we've seen the more than 500 witnesses testify Christ raised from the dead. Now what does it mean to how we live? Starting in verse 21. Since now, verse 20, Christ has been raised from the dead, what does it mean to us? Since by a man came death, that is Adam, by a man also came the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all shall be made alive. But each according to his own order. Christ, the first fruits. After that, those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers up the kingdom to God the Father, when he has abolished all rule and authority and power. That is, Jesus has concluded everything of this earth. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death. Now, he conquered death on the cross. That is our separation from God. The last enemy that will be abolished is the physical death, when there will no longer ever be any more physical death. At the end, Christ will abolish that. For he has put all things in subjection under Jesus Christ's feet. But when he says all things are put in subjection, it is evident that he is accepted who put all things in subjection to him. And when all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself also will be subjected to the one, that is the Father, who subjected all things to him, Jesus Christ, that God may be all in all. God is one, Father, Son, and Spirit. God himself wants us to live a holy life in Christ. He talks about why he himself is in danger every hour, because he testifies to the power of the resurrection of Jesus in verse 30. And he says in verse 31, I protest, brethren, by the boasting in you, which I have in Christ Jesus the Lord, I die daily. Physically, Paul lays his life on the line physically every day. I die daily. If from human motives I fought with wild beasts at Ephesus, what does it profit me? If the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. That was written by a Greek poet. But Paul says, according to the word of God, do not be deceived. Believer in Jesus Christ, do not allow the world or its philosophers or its poets or its writers or its movies corrupt you. Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Become sober-minded as you ought and stop sinning, for some have no knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. God wants us to live as his first fruits. We are to live here today by our faith in Jesus Christ, our love, our trust, our obedience, so that we can be shown to be different. Right now, in my backyard, I have fruit trees that are growing new fruit. And I expect my fig tree to actually produce ripe figs in the next 2 months. I'm not expecting tangerines. I'm not expecting thorns or thistles. I'm expecting figs to come from a fig tree. And if we are living in Christ, if we are drawing our life from him, if he's the true vine and we've been grafted into him, what life should we be manifesting and living and growing? What fruit should be growing in us? God himself. The fruit of the Holy Spirit. The fruit of Jesus Christ. That is the fruit of our life. We are to evidence whose we are. And the reality that we live our life in is Jesus Christ and not the world. So the world should see Jesus Christ. The world should see his fruit growing in us day by day. This is the evidence that we are his. Now, he gives us hope for the future. Paul had to deal with many aspects of suffering, many realities of persecution. When he mentioned fighting wild beasts in Ephesus, he was arrested more than once and thrown to wild beasts once at least. He was beaten with rods more than once, shipwrecked more than once. He was a prisoner of the Romans more than once. Paul suffered for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But God preserved his life up until the very end of his life, when he finally died in Rome. Paul knew where he was going. Paul knew he would be raised from the dead. And so when we read in 1 Corinthians 15, starting in verse 35, but some may say, how are the dead raised? Okay, that's a good question. Fair enough. And by what kind of body do they come back? Paul says with a little bit of humor, I think, you fool, that which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. Now, Jesus taught this. Jesus taught that you have to bury the seed in the ground for the seed to sprout, for the seed to die. It stops being a seed and it grows into a plant. It changes. It's transformed. It's no longer a seed. So God expects us to die so that we can become what he has truly always intended us to be. Consider, according to the word of God, that your body is a seed and it must die to self. It must die so that God can grow you and transform you to be what he's always intended and desired you to be. He continues in the word of God. And that which you sow now, you do not sow the body which is to be. You're not putting into the ground the body that will be what God is going to make it, but a bare grain, perhaps of wheat, perhaps something else. But God gives it, that is you, a body just as he wished, the desire of God, and to each of the seeds a body of its own. All flesh is not the same flesh. There is one flesh of men. There's another flesh of beasts. There's another flesh of fish. There's another flesh of birds. There are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies. But the glory of the heavenly one and the glory of the earthly is another. That is, they are very distinct, completely different. There is one glory of the sun. There's another glory of the moon. There's another glory of the stars. For stars differ from star in glory. Science tells us that. Scientists can measure stars. They can measure their different kinds of light. And they are all different. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It, the body, is sown a perishable body. It is raised, that it is brought up by God himself, an imperishable body. It is sown in dishonor. And we understand that. We know that all physical things that are buried when they're dead decompose. Science tells us this is the second law of thermodynamics, the law of entropy. It's the law of decay. All matter decays. All matter falls apart. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It's raised in God's power, not yours, not mine, the power of God. It is sown a natural body. It's biological. It's of this earth. It's the dust of this earth that God made us out of originally in Adam. There is also a spiritual body that God is creating for each of us. So also it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam, Jesus Christ, became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first the natural, then the spiritual. The first man, Adam, is from the earth, earthy. The second man is from heaven. As is the earthy, so also are those who are earthy. And as is the heavenly, so also are those who are heavenly. Let that soak in your heart for a minute. Is your being, your emotions, your desires, your thoughts, your affections, is your being heavenly or earthy? Which one focuses, attracts you, holds your attention? Where is your heart? And just as we have borne the image of the earthy, that is, we are all born biological babies of our mother and father, going all the way back to Adam and Eve, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly, that is, Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, God Almighty, glorified. His glory is brighter than the sun and all the stars. We shall bear the image of the heavenly, Jesus Christ. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood, your biological body, cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable, this mortal body, this flesh and blood must put on immortality. It's sown in death, the physical body. One of the realities of the COVID-19 virus is that there's a small percentage of everybody that gets the virus that actually does die. And the number is large of the total number of people around the world that have died, the total number of people in the United States. It's a large number that have passed away, young and old. It's a shocking reality. It's not just the old. But our physical bodies do die. A cold, a virus, the flu, COVID-19, pneumonia. These are all things that can attack our bodies and actually cause our bodies to die. It's meant to die eventually. We are all going to die. But in Christ, the hope, the reality of the power of God in us, even at this moment, is that this body is a seed that is meant to die. It's meant to be buried, so that God changes us and transforms us and raises us to be completely different, heavenly, not just of this earth. We're raised imperishable, according to verse 43, in God's glory and God's power. And I want you to think throughout Scripture, every place that God revealed His glory, how powerful was it when God revealed His glory to Moses on the mountain? How powerful was it when God revealed His glory to all the people of Israel when they were standing by the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army was coming to them, and God revealed His glory, stopping Pharaoh, separating the Red Sea, and allowing them to walk on dry land that had been underwater? God revealed His glory. When Jesus took the apostles, Peter, James, and John, on top of Mount Tabor, Jesus revealed Himself in all His deity, in all His godliness, in all His actual being God. He revealed Himself, and it stunned them, and they actually fell to the ground. God's glory is so great, it is absolutely overwhelming to us. And that's when God's just showing us a glimpse. We're not actually living in that reality as in being in heaven with Him at this moment. Peter, James, and John were made of the dust of this earth. They're standing on a small pile of dust of this earth called Mount Tabor, and Jesus revealed His glory there. And the Father and the Spirit revealed themselves there. It was overwhelming. Our mortal flesh really cannot handle the glory of God, but God intends us to be resurrected in His glory. And the new body we will have amazingly, will still be recognizable as you, as me. When we're in heaven with Jesus Christ, we will recognize each other. I can't wait to see my mom and dad again. I can't wait to see my friends and family that have gone on before me. I've got grandfathers who passed away before I was born, never met them. I'm hoping to see them in heaven. And I'm sure you think the same way. There's many people that you would like to see again. Perhaps some famous Christian you'd like to have a conversation with. How many of you would like to sit down with the Apostle Paul or Peter and actually have a conversation? We will be able to, and supernaturally will recognize them in heaven. But the glory of God is going to be, the power of God is going to be part of our reality. This weak flesh will be gone. You will have a new, imperishable body. Personally, I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to not having allergies anymore. I'm looking forward to not having a bad back anymore. I'm looking forward to not having to wear glasses anymore. The weaknesses of this body, I'm looking forward to laying them down and not picking them back up. How about you? Absolutely. So God is going to raise us up with a new body, recognizable as who we are, but with the glory and power of God as part of our being. We were born in the physical image of Adam. We're going to be raised by God in the heavenly image of Jesus Christ. The same body that Jesus rose with when he came out of the grave, that his disciples could see and touch. Remember? Jesus actually told the Apostle Thomas, here, put your hand in my side where the spear went into my heart. Go ahead, put your hand in me. You will have a body. You can touch it. You can see it. You'll have the ability to move and be like you are right now, only in the power and glory of God himself, Jesus Christ. Now, when will this happen? Well, the resurrection of all of us, where our bodies will be transformed, it's going to happen at the last trumpet. Matthew 24:31 and 1 Thessalonians 4:15-17. Say that at the last trumpet. Here in 1 Corinthians, verse 52, at the last trumpet. When the angel blows the last trumpet, everything happens. And it happens so quickly, it's actually described by the Apostle Paul in the twinkling of an eye. Now, a mathematician, smarter than I, actually figured this out. And so he calculated the distance from your cornea to the retina. And I don't know, it's about that far. I don't know what that is. 5/8 of an inch? I have no idea. But he calculated the average eyeball, cornea to retina, and how long it takes light to go from the cornea to the retina and then back out, to bounce back out. That's the twinkling. Light goes in, light comes out. That's the twinkling of an eye. So the speed of light is like, I have no idea what the speed of light is. It's fast for a mile, right? And so they calculate distances in space according to the speed of light. Do you know how fast that is when you're talking about just 5/8 of an inch? A lot smaller than 1 second, right? A nanosecond. It's a microsecond. It's just a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of less than 1 second. As fast as that is, it's nothing for God. He's going to say, raise, and we're going to be raised from the dead. And we're going to be transformed. We're going to have bodies in the glory and power of Jesus Christ, exactly like his body is now. So when God gives us this as his word, he gives us these instructions, he gives us this encouragement, he gives us this command. We're to live now according to the resurrection power of Jesus, sinless. We're not to sin anymore. We're to live according to his way of being and not the way of this world. What does this mean to us during the pandemic? How does this transform our emotions? How does this transform our thinking? Well, I think there's a few gifts in this that God gives us. First, we can live in a total and absolute secure peace. Even if I get the virus and die, if that is the will of God, okay, God, I'm going to be with you sooner. The Apostle Paul wrote that in Philippians. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Right now we live in secure peace in 2 Peter 3:14 and John 14:27 and John 16:33. We have the very peace of Jesus Christ here and now. He said he came to give us his peace. His peace, the peace of God here. So we have security no matter what circumstances are. And circumstances around the world for many believers, for many people, are just in tremendous suffering right now. I don't know if you saw the email newsletter we sent out this last week, but there are Christians in Haiti, in a small village, that they're suffering a tremendous drought. I mean, worse than California. They've got no water. And they have to walk 3 hours to the next town to try to get water. And this little remote village that has no water also has no COVID-19 virus. Not one person's gotten sick with the virus. They're so isolated. But if they know if they walk to the town to get water, to get food, they're going to be exposed to the virus because the town has it. So what would you do? You can't live without water. You can't live without food. So they're actually walking. And so they're praying. They're asking us to pray for God to release his rain and give them rain and fresh, sweet drinking water so they can live. This is something good that we can pray for. They have the peace of Jesus Christ in the midst of their suffering. They're asking us as fellow Christians to pray for them, to pray with them. And we can do that. We can know that around this world, our prayers matter. Cheryl and I pray every day, every night. We're praying for God to have mercy on the whole earth and for God to stop the pandemic and for God to heal the sick. I'm praying this every day. I invite you to as well. I have peace. And God wants you to have peace. Even though there is a pandemic, and depending on which health expert you listen to, we may have this pandemic for 3 more months. We may have this pandemic for 3 more years. The experts don't know. God alone knows. But our peace is not in what the CDC says. Thank God we have experts that have a lot of medical knowledge and some wisdom. We need them. Praise God for them. Every doctor, every nurse, every healthcare worker, thank you, Lord. But our peace is not dependent on them. Our peace is from God. Our security is from God. And we get to live in a heavenly peace that this world cannot take away. So we have security. We have peace in Jesus Christ. And then according to verse 57, when you read verse 57, 1 Corinthians 15, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God, we can live rejoicing. Every single day, we can wake up thanking God. Every single day, we can wake up praising God. All day long, we can thank God for many, many, many of his gifts and his loves. There are all kinds of ways that God shows his love and blessing. And I so appreciate Dr. Allen. He was my Hebrew professor when I was in seminary. And he shared this story one day in class that he was having a discussion at a conference. And he was speaking with another language expert who was not a believer. And the language expert was kind of mocking Dr. Allen for having faith in Jesus Christ. And Dr. Allen listened to him with respect and kindness. And he finally asked him, he said, well, when you woke up this morning, how is your brain working? He said, my brain works great. You know, the man was very proud of himself, proud of his ego, proud of his pride, proud of his accomplishments. Dr. Allen said, can you make your brain work? Do you have any control over how the health of your body works? Can you make your heart beat in rhythm? Can you make your diaphragm draw one breath? Can you do any of that by your thought? And the man thought for a second, and he admitted, actually, no, I can't. And none of us can. It is God that holds all of our lives in the palm of his hand. It's God that holds every atom in our bodies, every molecule. God, Jesus Christ, according to the book of Colossians, holds us together by the act of his will. And if you can get out of bed in the morning, thank God. If your brain is still working, thank God. If your lungs are still breathing, thank God. If you can go to your kitchen right now and get a glass of water, thank God. God, you've got clean drinking water. There are so many things, so many blessings from God that we have that we take for granted, that we really need to be a lot more thankful for. We can be thankful that we have the Word of God. We can be thankful that Jesus Christ has revealed himself to us. We can be thankful that He has forgiven every single one of our sins. There is so much to praise God for, to thank God for. So we can give praise, we can give rejoicing with every breath of our body, every day. It is Jesus Christ who gives us new life. It's Jesus Christ who gives us peace. He pours out His blessings and His love on us without measure. And so in Christ, we can live productive and peaceful lives, steadfast and immovable. I've been in situations throughout my life where circumstances were not always peaceful. I remember on Okinawa, I was on the school bus coming back to the Air Force Base because the school was off of the Air Force Base, and we're driving on the bus back on, and there was a riot. And there was a riot in the town that was outside the gate of the Air Force Base. And so our school bus had to go through this riot to get to the gate to get on the Air Force Base. It's the only way back on the base. As we're trying to go safely through the rioters, they surrounded the bus and they started rocking the bus like they were going to tip our bus over. At that moment, I'm sure everybody on the bus was a little excited, you know, maybe a little afraid. But at that moment, God sent out a whole patrol of armed Marines, and they came out and they surrounded our bus and they escorted us onto the base. The rioters let go of the bus. They backed off. We got on. We got home safely. Had a good story to share with our parents. All of us around this earth can share stories of near misses, you know, cars that almost hit us on the freeway but didn't. There's all kinds of things that happen in this world. No matter what happens, whether we have good circumstances in our minds or difficult, painful circumstances. And the truth is, all of us do have, at different times, painful, suffering circumstances. That's part of life. But in all these things, we can live peaceful and productive lives in Jesus, steadfast and immovable. He's our foundation. He is the rock that is bigger than I, according to Scripture. And every time I think of that, I think of El Capitan and Yosemite. That's a big rock. I think of Half Dome. That's a big rock. And you know what? Those are tiny little pebbles compared to Mount Everest. So think of whatever mountain, whatever rock that just captures your imagination, and think of how much bigger Jesus is. He's immovable, and He's our rock. So in Christ, we're steadfast. Nothing can shake us. And because of all this, according to verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, and Southside Community Church, I want to tell you that according to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, you are beloved of God. God Himself loves you. Doesn't matter what the world says, you are chosen and loved by God. You are beloved. So therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing, that is, with a concrete assurance, with an experience of participation already in Christ, that your toil, your work, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. It's not empty. It has substance in Christ. You can ceaselessly abound in the work of Jesus Christ. So think of it this way. It's not that as Christians we have a time clock or a time card to punch like we're going on to a job, like clocking in, punching the clock at Walmart, right? There's different businesses that want their employees to punch in and punch out. That's great, no problem with that. But in Christ, we get to ceaselessly live with an abounding work, that is, a labor that is of God, a labor that is in the resurrection power of Jesus, a labor that we never get tired of because it is sharing good news. It's not labor digging ditches. It's not labor roofing a really large roof when it's 104 degrees outside. It's the labor of sharing the love of Jesus. It's the labor of sharing good news with people that perhaps are really hurting and they haven't had good news in a long time. We get to share the best gifts of God with all people. And whatever their circumstances are, we can bring them. If they're thirsty, we can give them water and the living water of Jesus. If they're hungry, we can give them food and the bread of life, Jesus Christ. We can ceaselessly abound in this because God is infinite and His grace is infinite and His mercy is here now because Jesus rose from the dead. And in Christ, He's put us here to live that love with all people. So these are the ways we get to live here and now in the resurrection power of Jesus. Without fear. With no limit to how much God can do through us, because there's no limit to the resurrection power of Jesus. There's no limit to the good news. And we have confident assurance that we know what's going to happen. Like when that last trumpet sounds, we know what's going to happen. This body is going to be the seed in the ground transformed into the glory and power of God. All praise and glory to Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the one that rose from the dead and showed Himself to all His followers, even 500 at one time. And they testified to this all over the world. And we get to testify today of Jesus' love and resurrection life. We get to talk about life when the world wants to talk about death. What a gift God has given us. I hope that you are rejoicing and thankful. I hope that you go forward from this time that we have together right now with greater hope and greater assurance and even stronger peace in Jesus Christ, that you can ceaselessly abound in His work, in His resurrection power. God bless you. Hope to see you soon.